Hi, in this video, we're going to explore the app Swift Playgrounds. Let's take a look and see how to use Swift Playgrounds with Dash. To locate the Swift Playground app, place your finger in the center of the iPad screen and swipe down. Type Playground. Close the keyboard and tap on the Playgrounds app. On opening Swift Playgrounds, you'll find, press See All, you get a list of playgrounds for coding in Swift Playgrounds. Each of these playgrounds are fantastic and they're a great insight for students to be able to start to learn to code using text. So as we scroll down, there are pre-loaded playgrounds within Swift Playground, but we're looking to use Dash. So as we scroll down, we get to a list called From Other Publishers. And if we scroll across, you'll see there's a Wonder Workshop third-party app that we can use in Swift Playgrounds. This is a great option for secondary students in years 7 and 8 who are starting to learn to use script coding to access an app like this to develop those skills. So if I tap on Wonder Workshop and press subscribe, it's fetching the subscription and it will place it up in Swift Playgrounds. So you can now see that the playgrounds that are available includes the Wonder Workshop Dash. So if I tap on the Dash Playground and say get, and it's now loading that into the playground ready for us to use. Once the app has loaded into My Playgrounds, tap on Dash Book. Asks you a question and lets you know that it's a third-party app. Are you sure you want to open it? And we're going to say yes. This app comes from Wonder Workshop, and Wonder Workshop apps do not collect student information. So when we open it up, it has an orange button there saying Start Coding. Tap Start Coding. And when it loads, you can see we have information on the left to read through, and we have a little bit of an image to follow on the right. Again, this is like a tutorial and it's progressive. So it starts off small and it gets more difficult as you move through it, but it's a guided tutorial. So it's not something where the students wouldn't be able to do this independently, which is fantastic because they can move at their own pace. So it's race day. Dash is competing and needs to get to the big event, so the goal is to program him to drive along the path. You can see we've got an empty box on the left here, and above the box is Move Forward as well as below the box. If I tap in the box to enter the code, you'll see some coding options appear at the bottom of the screen. Move backward, move forward, turn left and turn right. If we look to the image on the right, you can see a map. You can see the blue arrow or the circle is where Dash is positioned on the map. They want Dash to follow that map. So we can see that we've got one move forward to the first white dot, which is already on the code above the box. But when we get to that first white dot, we can't move forward, we need to move right. So I can say turn right, and you can see when I tap on that in the bottom bar, turn right appears in the coding box on the left. Now I have to visualize looking at this map, which is really great for directions and learning left and right, the rest of the instructions that I need to give to Dash to complete that journey on the map. So he's going to then move forward, and once he moves forward, he goes forward, turns right, moves forward, then he's going to turn left, and then he's going to move forward, and then he's going to turn left again, and then he's going to move forward twice. And I know this because there are two dots for him to go to. He starts off on one dot and he has two dots to move forward on. So we're going to say move forward and move forward. Then we need to turn right. That's if I know my left from right. And once he turns right, then we're going to move forward, and then he's going to turn right again and move forward, turn left. And I won't put that last move forward in because you can see underneath the box, we already have a move forward there ready to go. So now I would run my code. But firstly, in Swift Playground, just like in the Wonder Workshop apps, we need to connect Dash. So you can see on the right side of the screen where the image is, in the middle of the screen, you can see the words connect Dash. So tap on connect Dash. And you can see there's Dash, I tap on Dash, and Ada is now connected. So it's waiting to start. Now at the bottom of the image, you can see a button with run my code and a start icon. So I'm going to place Dash on the ground. Make sure Dash has plenty of space to move and follow the instructions. And I'm going to press run my code. So Dash will physically move across the floor exactly as he is on the map. And once he's finished the code, and you can see it's showing you the progress in the orange box below Dash as he's going through. And we're finished. And we've been successful. So we get a confirmation message that says Dash has arrived. We can see a tick above Dash to let us know that our code was correct. And then we have next page. So if we click on next page in the box down below, we get our next challenge. And our next challenge is to actually, Dash needs fast reflexes. The goal is to program Dash's distance sensors to react to an obstacle. So we've gone from using text code to give simple instructions in driving, and now we're starting to look at using some of those sensors that are pre-built inside of Dash to detect obstacles. So we can see the code below, and we can see that the instructions above it are telling us that there is an if statement while true if there is an obstacle in front and it's true, play a sound, and then there's a break, and then while true, and there's a tap to enter code. So it wants us to add another if statement. And we have the motion command in order to make Dash move forward when the obstacle is removed. So while true, we're going to click in here. If obstacle is in rear, and we're going to say, it already puts the brackets in, and you see your options now are to press the equals. And now we want to say, if obstacle is in the rear, and we want this to be true, that if it's in the rear, then we want to, and I've pressed true. I need a bracket. So run code, if obstacle is true. Now, here's what I love. In this program, if the student is stuck at this point and not sure what else to put in, we've read the instructions, we know that it wants us to add another if statement to make Dash move forward when the obstacle's removed. So we might make that, well, look at the hint. Let's go on the right to the image, press hint. So while loop after one that is already written, don't forget to include a break statement. And you can see in the example above, for the one that it's already given us with an if statement, that there is a break statement there with play sound, sound type, car engine, break. So I can close that reminder. And we can, might make it false instead. So if obstacle in front, and we'll make it false. So I'm going to remove that by, on the right, you can see there's an arrow with a cross in it, and I'm moving back to delete that, and I'm going to say, is obstacle in front equals, and we want to say false. And then I'm going to use the return. So next to, in the bottom right, you can see there's an arrow on its own, in between the up arrow and the arrow with a cross. So I'm going to hit that return, and that gives us a new line. And now what we want to do is say that is, this is our break statement, is obstacle in front false, then we want to move forward. And so then we've got a return, and we want to put our run my code, waiting to start. It's checking the front for anything in front. So if I put my hand in front of dash, and there's an obstacle in front, so it plays the sound of a car engine, and then there's a brake, and while true, if the obstacle is false, move forward. And at the moment, dash is continuing to move across the floor. So if I want to stop it, I'll press stop underneath the orange box. You can see a blue square with the word stop next to it. I'm going to tap on stop, and it says waiting to start. You can also see on the left-hand side next to run my code, if we tap on this, we've got step through my code, step slowly, and enable results. So we can actually slow down and have an indicator on the side of our code to show us where the code is up to. So if we step through my code, and you can see we've got a highlighter showing over the words where the code is up to when you press play. I'm going to press stop. So this is starting practice. If I press the cross in the top white of this instructions, I come back to my dash book. There are a number of things to move through in the dash book, a number of challenges. And you can see that if we press plus, we have other conditions here that we can add in underneath and instructions of what they are. So if we're learning text coding and we're not sure what those brackets mean, we can click on the plus, we can get that extra information that the curly brackets can be used as a variable, or perhaps we've got a repeat here where the arrow goes around in a circle or a loop. And so you can see that there are different indicators here for what they mean. And if you click on the picture, at the moment there's no images and no files, but you could insert files there as well. The three dots to the right of the plus, if we click on those, and you can see that there is help when you're using playgrounds, documentation, glossary. You can take a picture of your dash actually performing those tasks, create a PDF of the code that you have created, record a movie, you can even broadcast live, and you can share the text that you've created. So if we click on share text, and we have options to airdrop this, maybe airdrop it to, in the workflow in a classroom might be to airdrop your code to your teacher, or perhaps you might upload it to a OneNote, to sketches, to notes, email, and there are other options. For example, Google Drive. You could add it into your Google Drive and access it on another device. So this is Swift Playgrounds. Thank you for joining in, and be sure to check out our other videos, if you haven't already, on how to use the apps Path, Blockly, and Wonder.
This video is part of a series of support videos all about the kit that you have borrowed. To find the other videos in this series, head to the Learning Library and visit the kit page for the equipment you've borrowed. You can also find the full list of support videos for all of our kit on the YouTube channel. You can also join us in the Yammer community. If you have any questions or you'd like to ask teachers how they've used the equipment in their classroom, then why not join us on the STEM T4L Facebook community? It's a closed group. You can ask teachers how they've used the equipment and also share the work samples that your students have created.